love, it's your call. I'm here right now and I want it all. Let's have some fun, let's get stupid, let's get dumb.
How do you stash for a hunger situation? Maybe you're a skinny-jeaned hipster who stashes one in your beard. Show us your ideal stashing location on our Spotify playlist generator, and we'll create a custom Ritz Crackerfuls playlist to match. Just click the Ritz Crackerfuls banner on the bottom left-hand corner of your screen to get started.
Test, test, 1, 2, 3, test. 1, 2, 3, test. Excuse me. If we can get people to take their seats, we'd love to start with the program. We got some great speakers lined up, so if folks can clear the demo pit in the back, that'd be fantastic. Hey, Kayvon. Kayvon, your mic is live.
Stanford Sarnax.
Yeah.
We sponsor Rockville.
Very cool.
Crank Kayvon up. Get him to yell at these people.
Nope.
That's me.
Hey, Gene, do you have your gym card up here?
What number of mic does he have?
No, I do not.
What number of mic does he have?
I'm sorry, serious?
What number is he have?
He's on two.
No, he's not. I'm on two.
Why don't I just use a handheld?
She's right. You know what? I did you on the wrong one.
I'll be back.
So, here's introduce them to see more action. Right. Okay.
Yep. Hello. Okay.
I
all take a seat right now, that'd be great.
Steve?
Yeah,
I have Steve, Sumit, Mikhail, David, and Ned. And then
the true adopters of Internet of Things will understand the importance of timing. Data collected from the internet saying the show will begin. Hi, how are you? If we could please grab a seat, that would be great. Don't make me come and get you. Hey, Paul, Derek, can we get people to come in?
Hey, Kayvon, the best thing we can do is just start.
Okay.
So
am I off or am I on?
You're off right now, because I don't want people to hear you having
right,
conversations that you might not want them to hear. So, tell me what you want me to go on, and then you introduce you.
Yeah, no, you don't want to just say, hey, you know, maybe talk a little about the internet things, and then introduce me, and then I'll say a little bit about NestGSV.
Cool.
And talk, and then that's just. But I want you to kind of lay the foundation.
All right, we're just going to get started and let people find their way. Yep. So good afternoon, and welcome to NestCon 1.2, the Internet of Things. So we got very excited about the Internet of Things here at NestCon when we began to do a series of hackathons and really work with some very interesting companies in our community who were focused in this space. The idea that devices connected to the internet could create this proactive and very helpful environment, could take advantage of trends in big data, in the cloud, and to really impact our lives in very interesting ways. We decided today that we wanted to focus on three areas of the Internet of Things. We're going to talk about the connected body, the connected car, the connected vehicle, and the connected home. So today's going to be a deep dive on all of those things, and our goal here with every NESCON is really that you arrive curious about the market that we are in, and that you leave feeling better informed, having met great people, been introduced to some exciting startups, and really feel like you're ready to move more quickly around this market area. A couple of quick housekeeping items before we jump in further. First, this is being live streamed, and so we welcome all of those people who are sharing the afternoon with us on our live stream, which is at nesttv.xtvguide.com. If you on the live stream or here would like to Twitter or Facebook post around the event, we're asking you to use the hashtag NESTCON. And some of you received an email, I hope all of you received an email about the PointView application for Android or iPhone. If you have that application, you can use that to submit questions or comments that we can make available to the panelists during our discussions throughout the afternoon. In addition, we'd love to have you be part of the conversation. And a really efficient way to do that in a room of this size is through note cards. So we have note cards and Sharpies, and we'll make those available to you. We'll be collecting them throughout the panel sessions and integrating your questions into the Q&A. So with that bit of housekeeping, I'd like to introduce Keyvan and invite him up to the stage. Keyvan, as many of you know, is the CEO of Nest GSV and really the brains behind NESTCON. So talk a little bit about what we're doing.
Well, thanks, Chris, and welcome, everybody. And first of all, let's give a round of applause for Chris Shipley. You forgot to introduce yourself, Chris. So Chris has joined our team, and we're really excited to have her. For those who don't know her, she's been the producer of Demo for 12 years. She's been a technical writer. She's an author. She's been advisor to thousands of companies. So we're really proud to have her on part of the Nest GSV team.
My goal is to be incognito.
That's the other Chris. But anyway, once again, welcome. How many of you, is it your first time visiting us here at Nest GSV?
Okay, welcome.
So for those of you, this may be a little bit of a repeat. I have the great pleasure of always saying the same thing over and over and over again. So my conversations are always very boring. But for those who don't know, Nest GSV is a platform, we're a technology innovation center, and we're a platform that brings together large corporations, governments, startups, and universities together to leverage technology to solve big problems. So today, problems around transportation, healthcare, education. We believe that no single entity is going to be able to solve it on their own. However, and a platform where we could bring those entities that have similar objectives and initiatives, we believe we won't even touch the surface and we can solve any problem there is. And that's the platform that Nest GSV brings to the table. And, this Internet of Things conference, it's not new, right? We've been talking about the Internet of Things for a long time, but it is here and it's now. For those of you who don't understand what the Internet of Things is, it's about when there is more devices than people connected to the Internet. And that is today. I know in my household, I have a family of four, and we probably have 15 devices connected. And I'm not a technologist. I'm not one of those early adapters, even though I run an innovation center. That's just my household. So think about what's going on. And if you think about, where we are from, just the history of the earth, right? And when it comes to humans and innovation, if you think that the turn of the century was the second industrial revolution, and I actually took notes here, and I took five notes, and then maybe in the 40s and 50s, it was the atomic age and the atomic revolution. And if in the 80s, if it was the digital revolution, and in the early 2000s, it was the information revolution, we are for sure, undoubtedly, because of the Internet of Things and the innovation revolution. Because there's not an entity that exists that does not need to have a strategy around innovation to become relevant to their clients and to be relevant to themselves and to increase their market shares. So it's really exciting times, and that's why you see this explosion of accelerators and incubators, because what's happening is it's now very easy to develop technology, cloud computing, open source, and you name it. We have people from Visa here, we have people from AT&T. There's a cross-section of large corporations here, and they all have an interest in the Internet of Things. And I think, you know, we were talking about this whole thing, and when did it all start, and when it all became, you know, kind of when was all brought about, and I ran into this video, actually a TV commercial in 1993. And I don't know, with Tom Selleck and his corporate sponsor. So, you know, before we go into our next keynote speaker, I want to show this video in 1993, 20 years ago, we were talking about the Internet of Things. Thank you.
Have you ever borrowed a book from thousands of miles away, across the country, without stopping for directions? Or sent someone a fax from the beach? You will. And the company that'll bring it to you, AT&T.
By the way, we're not sponsoring them, even though they're a partner of ours.
Have you ever paid a toll without slowing down? Bought concert tickets from a cash machine? Or tucked your baby in from a phone booth? You will. And the company that'll bring it to you, AT&T. Have you ever opened doors?
I'm home.
With the sound of your voice? Car, car, please. Carried your medical history in your wallet.
Your wife's gonna be just fine.
Or attended a meeting.
I really like that you guys have been doing, but
in your bare feet.
And they have a few other ideas.
You will. And the company that'll bring it to you, AT&T.
I think we should get sponsorships from AT&T.
Have you ever watched the movie you wanted to? The minute you wanted to? Learn special things.
That's all taken from jazz.
Now any questions?
From faraway places.
Oakland?
So where did jazz come from?
Good question.
Or tucked your baby in from a phone booth? You will. And the company that'll bring it to you, AT&T.
So what's a phone booth? So what was futuristic two decades ago, it looks more like a history lesson today. We're going to take some time now, the rest of the afternoon, to really dive down into this past that's brought us to this future. And I think there's no better place to start than with our first keynote speaker, who we'd actually spend most of the rest of the afternoon really digging into some of your very interesting experience as a physician, as a businessman, an entrepreneur, an inventor. Our first speaker, our keynote, Yan Chao, is the director of innovation at Kaiser Permanente, and I think we'll set a great context for our session today. So, Jan, I welcome you to NESCON, and thank you very much in advance for your remarks.
Hello. Thanks, Chris. It's a pleasure to be here. So there is a story I like to tell at some of my talks about the great physicist Albert Einstein. And there was many years ago when he was teaching at Princeton, he was on a train when he saw the conductor coming down the aisle looking for tickets. So he goes and goes like this, uh-oh, where's my ticket? So he checks his bag, he checks his pocket, not to be found. So the conductor, young guy, comes up to him and says, oh, Professor Einstein, don't worry about it. I know who you are. I know who you are. Don't worry about it. I'm sure you paid for the ticket. Forget about it. So Einstein said, thank you. So the guys kept walking down the aisle. And then so before he left the train, he looked back, and there's the great man on his hands and knees looking for the ticket. So the young man runs back and says, Professor Einstein, I know who you are. Not to worry, I trust you. And the great man goes, young man, I know you know who I am. I just need to find out where I'm going. And that's like healthcare. Right? We actually don't really have a clear view into the future, but it's an exciting time. And there's a lot of people looking at healthcare from many different domains. And so let me tell you a little bit about what I'm doing. I'm at Kaiser Permanente, if you guys don't know. It's the largest private integrated healthcare system in the U.S. We have about 9 million members. And the most important thing about this slide is that we're an integrated system, which means that the payer, the provider, the physicians are all in the same system, which has serious implications for incentives and things like that. We also have the largest, most advanced EHR deployment, electronic health record, and a patient health record that's used by over two-thirds of our members. My group is the Innovation and Advanced Technology Group. It's only 7 years old, and it has clinicians, analysts, and many other kinds of people, and we really have three parts to our mission. The first is we create innovation. So we look at things that are coming to the market and coming in about 2 to 5 years. So since we've been around 7 years, some of the things we saw many years ago are starting to cross over into the mainstream. We also have an internal fund for innovation where we sponsor projects by any employee who has a good idea. And this is really something because money talks. So we've had, and I'll talk a little bit about that later, we've had a lot of interest internally. We also communicate, so we connect people, innovators. I've had a lot of very much this kind of experience where people come up, let's say a physician has a great idea, tells me kind of under his, you know, kind of whispers, nobody else at Kaiser has heard about this. And he's a 20th guy that's talking. So communication within an enterprise is very important. We're associated with the Garfield Innovation Center, which is just in San Leandro across the bay. It's gotten a lot of awards. It's a 37,000 square foot, basically a previous warehouse. And what it does is, it's a place where we do space design, workflow simulation, and technology testing. It does offer public tours. We've had over 50,000 visitors from 42 countries, including the health ministers of certain countries, and the USCTO, and also the HHS secretary. This is our hospital ward simulation inside the center. Fully functional, high fidelity with an electronic record running. Our operating room of the future, even a home environment for testing telehealth. So what does the connected member mean to us? I think it's we're on the cusp of a new age. I think medicine is going to have to change for many reasons. But one of the ways it's going to change is that the way we deliver healthcare is going to be very different in the future, partly because we have no choice. We're short of physicians, we have fewer and fewer resources per patient, fewer, less reimbursement, and greater demand. So here's a picture of the connected health ecosystem. As many, many groups on it, and we have a patient in the middle named Bob. Some of these, many of these things like the pharmacy, imaging lab, and so on, are actually within Kaiser Permanente. Some are not, like regulators. And then we kind of think about how does the care coordination happen that's necessary, the shared practice standards that are also necessary, sharing of information, accountability frameworks, reimbursement and reporting, all very important, all the things that the accountable care organizations are trying to do these days. There's also another layer of people who are closer to the patient and sort of becoming more and more involved. I've seen quite a number of startups trying to involve these folks, like caregivers, visiting RNs, advocates, and so on. And then finally, closer to the patient, there are a lot of technologies that are being brought into focus to various degrees of success. So I've seen four care models. We've done a lot of work in telehealth, virtual care, and so on. And the Internet of Things involves sensors. And that's very much part of virtual care. The first model is live video. Now, this has been around for many decades, so it's not a new technology, but it's probably where we have the most interest. We have many, many pilots across the organization. The problem with live video is it's synchronous, so you have to, everybody has to be there at the same time. And it's a scheduling issue and really does not save time. so the physician actually is not more productive. Then the store and forward, so you take a photo or a video, and this actually is more effective, more efficient. We found in our teledermatology pilots that a teledermatologist can see a patient in about 7 minutes, as opposed to 20 minutes in an in-person visit, because they just look at the rash and they can make a diagnosis. Remote monitoring, we have a lot of, okay, I think we're echoing here a little bit. So we have a lot of sensors in the home these days, a lot of interest. In fact, many of the conferences I went to this year, many of the vendors were showing new monitoring technology and new ways to send data and so on. And this is another model that's very promising. And finally, there's a new model coming out called guided self-service. And the companies doing these kind of models are actually trying to enlist the help of social networks and caregivers and so on, which is very exciting because when you think about it, we don't really have, we will not have enough resources. The healthcare organizations that provide care will not be able to do these kind of things without a lot more help. So enlisting the folks that would have an interest to do this, very exciting. Here's a picture of some of the telemonitoring hubs and sensors that we've seen over the years. On the left side, you see some hubs, including video conferencing hubs, different form factors depending on the target population. You'll notice the Bosch unit only has four buttons, the one in the middle, with a big type size and a loud volume for the elderly. And you'll see very sophisticated other things, that the things that you wear, watches as a watchroom basis, and so on. Number one is a new glucometer from IVG Star, just FDA approved, the size of a flash drive. So you plug it into your iPhone, off you go. Number two is a local startup called CellScope, which has an attachment for your iPhone where you can look into your ear. It's an otoscope. This is going to save a lot of trips to the ER for patients' parents. And then number four is a mobile ultrasound that is attached to a smartphone. That's also very exciting. If you know ultrasound, if you had kids in the hospital, there are machines that are about this big. And having something you can plug into a cell phone is pretty amazing. But I want to talk a little about some of the other things we've seen that tie into virtual care and future care delivery that you might not think of. The first area is environmental computing. You've seen a lot of technologies in this area. You'll see in number one, that's actually a company called Kai Medical from Hawaii, and they have a touchless vital signs sensor that can sense your vital signs at a distance using Doppler radar. That came out of the military. And very interesting because, for instance, in our Garfield Center, we have it set up to sense newborn premature infants without touching them. Very important. Number three is a drowsiness sensor. You'll probably start seeing that in cars. You know, as you get drowsy as you're driving, the driverless car will drive you to a hospital. Number four is interesting. I just found this on the internet. Buttocks ID. You know, so you know everybody's buttocks have a certain profile. So when you sit in the chair in the car seat, if it doesn't match, you can't start the car. So if you lose weight, you gain weight, you're in trouble. Number five is a whole host of companies we've seen lately that have a mattress pad, under mattress pad that's no wires, but can sense your vital signs and pressure. And I think the stimulus for that was the fact that CMS, Health Medicare, is not going to pay for falls in the hospital anymore. It used to be that if you were post-op and you're kind of groggy, you try to get out of your hospital bed, even though you're not supposed to, and you fall and you break your hip, then you have to stay in the hospital six more weeks. And guess who pays for that? Medicare used to pay for that. Now they don't. So in this system, one of the systems we saw, for instance, if the patient sits up and all the pressure goes to the side of the bed, an alert is sent to the nurse to come into the room quickly, stop the patient, let me help you before they fall. So it's interesting how these kind of penalties and reimbursements drive the care delivery model. Number six, of course, is a company that makes a portable EKG, live EKG streaming from an iPhone case. A live core does that. This is a company in the UK called Plessy. And finally, Corning has developed these interfaces, sort of environmental interfaces. Here's a bathroom mirror that you can read your email if you can't get untethered. You can read your email while you're brushing your teeth. And It's that was a good article on tethering this week. Wearable sensors of great concern and interest to this group, I'm sure. I've seen a number of different kinds of sensors over the years, including number 7, disposable sensors, sensors that tell you vital signs that have a wireless transmitter built in. The cute little baby in number 6 is wearing a sensor suit, fabric sensors, for sudden infant death, a lot more reliable. In fact, as a pediatrician, I used to see parents, I could always tell, they come in at 6 months, and they have the largest bags under their eyes because they have not slept for 6 months because their baby is on an alarm. And every night, the wire falls off, and they run to the baby's room. You can imagine doing this several times a night because the thing fell off. So they are very much in favor of this. We have personal emergency response systems like pendants and wearable things for fitness, and, of course, the Nike Plus shoe. And then we have medication adherence. A lot of activity in this area. This is a very big problem. It accounts for 10% of hospitalizations in the U.S., 23% of nursing home admissions. And so you see a lot of reminder devices, a lot of, you know, watches and mobile phone things. Number 1 is a magnetrace necklace. So you wear the necklace. It's not real aesthetic, but you wear it. And every pill has a magnet. So as you take the pill, it sends a signature to the sensor, sends a signal to your provider that you took that pill. Then you're walking around with a lot of magnets in your stomach. So if you walk past a fridge, I mean, you're hard. So, and then number 2, of course, is the Proteus Raisin. Lots of venture funding. It's pills that have actually electronics, biodigestible electronics inside the pill. And then 3rd is a company called Exhale Therapeutics, which is actually, I think, a bit more elegant. What they do is they coat each pill with a biomarker. So you take the pill, it goes into stomach acid, the biomarker comes off and comes out in your breath. It's like a breathalyzer. I think that'd be probably more appetizing to people who take pills than electronics, but I don't know, maybe in the future not. We've looked at a lot of robots. The 2 in the middle are telepresence robots where physicians can round on their patients at a distance. Saves a lot of travel, and sometimes allows a physician to be more productive. So we've looked at the Vigo, we looked at the iRobot version. These are the robots that you tend to see in ads with the white coat on them to make them look like a doctor. I don't think it works, but you'll see the doctor's face and you can actually connect with the robot in with certain sensors. You see in number 1, a prosthetic to help people rehab their arms. Number 2 is a medication adherence robot. Number 3 is interesting, is a companion robot. For the elderly, especially those who are living alone, it's a great thing. We used to have one at the Garfield Center that was at the entrance. And so as you walk, it would kind of look at you and purr. You know, you just want to stroke it. When you stroke it, it purrs and it just, oh, that's great. Number 4 is, of course, legally blind driver driving a Google driverless car. Huge implications. In fact, when I was at Consumer Electronics Show this year, Audi is planning to bring out a driverless car in 10 years. That's not very long. Huge implications for the elderly and living at home and aging in place. Number 8 is a local company, Berkeley Bionics, bringing in exoskeletons, which can be, of course, communicating with the internet and so on, but ability to actually walk if you're a paraplegic. Pretty amazing. Natural interfaces are another area of great interest. We have people using the Kinect to play music. Nintendo Wii, that's actually a woman who got whacked in the eye with a controller. So it's actually a very dangerous sport, Nintendo. So it's a Wii casualty. Number 4 is a new company from the last 2 years called Tobii, which is tracking your eye gaze. Pretty amazing. So if you have difficulty using a computer keyboard or a mouse, you can actually look at the screen and the computer will calculate, use algorithms to see if you're confused or you want to do this or that or whatever. And the number 5 is a map of where you're looking in that picture. Number 6 is a science experiment, which is really interesting. It's actually a speech recognition based on electrical signals. So you don't have to actually say it to recognize your speech. It just analyzes the signal going through your vocal cords. So in a loud environment, or an environment where you're articulate, it can be very helpful. Augmented and virtual reality, you know, Google Glass is right now at the top of the hype curve, and we just got a pair. So Google Glass, Vuzix, a number of companies are making these sort of augmented reality glasses with huge potential in medicine. You can think both from the provider point of view and the patient point of view. If they have a pair of these glasses, they could theoretically look at their pill, and it could tell them, is this a pill you're supposed to be taking? Should you have refilled it? What time did you take it? And so on and so forth. Very, very interesting. You can even do language translation and so on. Number four is virtual reality. Patient at University of Washington, a burn patient getting operated on the left hand. In the right hand, he's playing a video game. The video game is something called Snow World. So in his mind, he's immersed in this world that's very cold. So it's cold. What do you think happens? He's numb. He can't feel a thing. So it's actually, he's playing this game, and the surgeon is operating his hand without any conventional anesthesia. This is virtual reality anesthesia. Very, very cool. Could hurt later, though. I don't know. Number six is an app that's been out for a little while. It's called WordLens. It's an iPhone app. And actually, you see what it does. You use the iPhone camera, and it does real-time translation of traffic signs into Spanish. And can you imagine a patient walking to a hospital who speaks Chinese and use a phone and take a picture of the sign to find out what the sign says, or even speak in their language? Very, very cool. Number seven is a company called Forterra that we worked with for a number of years to actually recreate our digital future hospital ward in cyberspace, and we actually run multi-user nursing training scenarios very successfully. Interesting about virtual reality, people who play virtual reality games, they often are less reluctant to say what's on their mind. If you run a nursing simulation with real physicians, real nurses, many times the nurses are too embarrassed to speak up, but not online. So it's a good thing. And finally, just want to mention a couple of next generation technologies we've seen. The number two is mind control. Of course, it's an EEG headset from NeuroSky. There's a couple of other companies doing that, where it's looking at theta waves and using it to control video games, or in this case, a physical game. We have a sample in the Garfield Center. The problem with thought control is you have to be in control of your thoughts. So, very interesting. In fact, one of the examples is number three. There's the Free University of Berlin actually has a car that's rigged up with an EEG headset to drive it by thinking. But you think about that, it's pretty amazing. You know, stop and go, turn right, go faster. The problem is if you think McDonald's, the car's going to go to McDonald's. That's an issue. So, number four is a company called C10 that I spoke with, a startup that makes these sort of tattoo type of sensors that you can just slap onto your skin, just the width of a hair, and they have a transmitter built in. So their first product is actually addresses the controversy of kids playing football. You know, kids play football, they get these concussions, and there's a lot of debate about how can you tell whether they should go back in the game or not? So their first product is this sort of a cap that they put out under the helmet that has tons of these sensors, pressure sensors. So it gives you a score. So the coach doesn't have to guess. And the coach is not a physician, doesn't have to guess. There's a number, and then you just sort of sit on a bench because you've had too many impacts. So very, very interesting. Number five is a tongue-driven wheelchair. And number six, finally, is a bioimplant, an eye for a blind person. And that does bring up a lot of issues, because as people create more and more of these sensors and enablers and devices, we are actually going to get into the human 2.0 ethical question. It will create more digital divides, and it will be a lot of people arguing about whether we should do things like that. But it's just, you know, technology never listens to that. Technology is its largest redhead. So. Things to ponder. In terms of Internet of Things, people are talking about, oh, big data, let's do analytics, and so on and so forth. But the real reality is that physicians are already overwhelmed by data. If you look at Internet of Things, there are 35 million devices on the Internet. Data must be converted into actionable information. So if you do a lifetime of blood pressures every 10 days, that's 6 terabytes. some quantified cell folks are advocating a blood pressure every hour. That's 1,460 terabytes in your lifetime. And that's just blood pressure. So the question is, what do we do with this data? You know, is it acceptable to use exception-based, you know, flagging and intervention? And the vendors themselves are also resistant, we found, to robust data exchange for many, many reasons. And this also hinders analytics. So the idea that you can take all this data, bring it together, and create an actionable recommendation is still pretty far from reality without some basic basic negotiation and agreements to go through. So what is our evaluation process at Kaiser? Our innovation group is actually very unique. I don't know of any other healthcare organization that has anything like this. So we are, in a sense, we're kind of pioneering. And so this is what we've come up with. We have two innovation pathways that we handle. There are many others in our organization. The first one is the external. So we've looked at over 1,600 technologies, probably close to 2,000 by now, of which we've done deep dives into 300 startups or 300 companies, and 10 have gone into production. On the internal side, we run a innovation fund, or iFund, that provides several $100,000 for any employee who has a good idea. So we've had over 700 proposals and funded 82 grants, of which 14 have gone into production. And it's interesting because those internal innovation projects, maybe a physician or a physician group or a physical therapy or whatever, about half of them are clinicians, they may have a vendor in mind. So sometimes that brings in a startup to try new technology. We have a couple of projects like that going on right now. So the process we usually go through is intake and meetings, pipelines, stakeholders, pilot. And then between the pilot and the business case, there's often a gap. Because what I call the O gap, the operations gap. To actually get it into operations, it will probably take a year or 2 years because of the budget cycle. And so after you decide to make it an operational system, you have to productize it, which means you have to make sure it's reliable, make sure it's robust and scalable, and so on and so forth. And finally, into operations. So this is what we go through, the initial screening when we look at a company. It looks very familiar, I'm sure, if you talk with venture capitalists, except we're doing it from the customer point of view. What is the problem? A lot of times when we're talking about companies, they have a solution that's looking for a problem. And there are still companies like that. And so what is the proposed solution? The benefits and risks, the impact on various things, including infrastructure, and then the financial analysis, and finally the recommendations. And we always make a recommendation. Here's an example. It was a startup a couple of years ago, maybe 4 or 5 years ago, that had a box for the operating room, some kind of box. And so being a tech company, they came to us and said, you know, our box is 99.9% reliable. You guys know what 99.9% is? It's 99.999% reliable. So that's fine. So I brought them to the OR in our Garfield Center. And I said, it's great, your box is 99.9%. What happens in this room? What's the error rate in this room? Right? That's a very, very good question. So they didn't know. They just kind of guessed. Well, there's been some studies. And here are some numbers. It's really interesting. When you look at the error rate, as you go down the scale, it gets more and more. It gets greater. At the bottom is the error rate under very high stress when dangerous activities are occurring rapidly. And that's the OR, right? That's life and death at stake. It's like combat. It's life and death at stake, multiple work streams, chaos. What's the error rate? It's 25%. Luckily, most of those errors don't kill you, hopefully. This is from a 1997 study. So I told the vendor, what do you think would make us pay attention? If you change your interface in your box to reduce human error, that's compelling. If you make your box talk with other boxes to reduce error, that's compelling. But telling us it's 99.9% doesn't buy us a lot. So then the vendor got it. But it's interesting because I think the lesson for vendors and startups that approach enterprises is that there are lots of barriers and challenges, but you have to keep a focus on what the problem is. So let me go through some of the barriers. Evidence. The first thing people will ask is, what's the evidence that your product is actually going to do something interesting or beneficial. That has many meanings. The standard of practice, it's actually risky to go out and do things that nobody else is doing, especially in healthcare. What's the business model? What's the workflow? A lot of these things disrupt workflow like crazy. And unless you have a very strong advocate in the organization, it's very hard to sometimes get things to change. Metrics. Here's a really interesting one. Telemedicine has been around a long time. And so the question is, why hasn't it been adopted? Why haven't people used mobile devices to measure themselves and whatnot? And it turns out that in all the studies that have been done in the literature, there's actually a lot of debate and conflicting studies. And so the thought is now that instead of looking for outcomes that are traditionally measured, like length of stay, readmission rate, mortality, maybe we should be looking at other things, other metrics that are actually harder to measure, like hospital performance, patient satisfaction, things like that. Integration, of course, Kaiser is a big issue. Reimbursement, huge issue. Scalability for our organization. And that does bring up the question of, should innovation always be scalable across the whole company, or can it be local? And that's an infrastructure and a policy question. Regulation, that's huge. Legal risk and ethics. So the key lesson is really, whose shoes are you standing in? So, and you know, it's really interesting because I've been in startups, and you tend to drink your own, you know, punch. You drink your own magic punch, and you kind of think, if only they would see it, they would buy it. But actually, you really need to look at yourself and try to figure out, if you're standing in somebody else's shoes and really trying to stand in their shoes, you will get much further in terms of designing your products and making something that will make a difference. So this is a good lesson to remember. And finally, the cartoon. The world of medicine as we know it will end soon, no doubt. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm going to ask you to stay for just a quick second because it's fascinating, and we have time for a couple of quick questions as we trade over, and no one's eager to No, please, go ahead.
It so happens that tonight I'm actually going to a big data conference associated with the Hadoop Summit next week, and this problem you described where